Hello, everybody. I'm Max Harbuck, and you're watching the Central Alabama High School Sports Show. We want to welcome you to the only show that's devoted to high school athletes in the state of Alabama. Of course, Snapper Lancaster is the host, but Snapper, his wife, is having some medical tests, and so he couldn't be here, but I'm delighted to be here in this really pretty clubhouse here in Ross Bridge in the Sawyer Trail neighborhood. And we appreciate the folks at Ross Bridge to allow us to use this beautiful facility. We're right in the middle of high school spring sports, and tonight in our first segment, we're going to be talking to one of the outstanding high school baseball teams in the Birmingham metro area, Coach Adam Mosley, who is the head coach of the Hoover Buccaneers. He will be here, and he has the Buccaneers kind of right in a great position to make the playoffs. He'll bring three of his players with him, three of his outstanding seniors. And then in the second half of the show, we're going to rerun a previously aired show with Dr. Jeff Dugas with Andrew Sports Medicine, and he'll be talking about sports medicine, and you'll want to see that. So we'll be right back following these messages.
The community features a world-class resort and spa, the amazing Robert Trent Jones Trail Golf Course, miles of historic trails, and the whole family loves the pool at Ross Park.
Now, are we gonna have to watch your vacation slides all night?
This was supposed to be a party.
Well, this isn't my vacation. I live here.
Ooh.
The next time you need electrical work, whether it be commercial or residential, you need to call Huffman Electrical Contractors. A company that's been in business for over 35 years, they've served clients not only locally in the Birmingham area and all over the state, but have clients outside the state of Alabama as well. Whether it's a new building or remodeling an older building or home, they can handle the job for you. Once again, that's Huffman Electrical Contractors. The number to call is 205-661-5005. That's 205-661-5005. We're at Huffman Electrical Contractors. A satisfied customer is always their number one objective.
You know that you're blessed. Give your taste a whole new spin. Bring your friends and come on in. Take your taste to a different place. It's the taste of hamburger heaven.
All right, welcome back to the Central Alabama High School Sports Show. I'm Max Harbuck sitting in for Snapper Lancaster, and in this first segment, as we talked about in the opening segment, delighted to have the head baseball coach from Hoover High School, Adam Mosley. And Coach, appreciate you cutting practice short and being with us today. And you know, we had talked off the air earlier today, but I wanted you to tell me a little bit about yourself, mm-hmm. And then we'll talk about your 2017 team.
Okay. Grew up in Huntsville. Went to Grissom High School, and then my senior year we moved to Virginia. My dad got transferred from a job, but we moved up there, and then knew I wanted to come back to college here, so went to Birmingham Southern. Played for Coach Shoup. Really lucky to have that experience.
And good coach.
Fantastic. Better man than a coach, though. And then after college, decided I wanted to try and go learn from the best, and so went to coached with Coach Dunn over at Vestavia for 3 years, and then went to Moody for a couple, and then back home to Grissom for 11 years, eight of them as the head coach, and then been here. This is my third year here.
Well, as everyone knows that baseball in this area, you know, Sammy Dunn was a legend. Mm-hmm. Talk about how much he influenced you and how you coach. You know, your style of coaching.
Sure. Well, I think, you know, nobody could ever coach like Coach Dunn did. It's just not going to be possible. But maybe the thing that you know, I get asked this question a lot, and the thing that I got the most from Coach Dunn is that, you know, every day is a chance to get better in everything you do. And And, you know, he coached every kid. He had, you know, when I was there, he had 30 kids, 40 kids, it seemed like, on the roster, and he coached number 30 as hard as he coached number one. And a lot of coaches don't do that. And, you know, I'm not going to say we're perfect at it, but we sure do try to coach all our kids. And you know, I think that's maybe the biggest thing, you know, and actually Coach Davis gave Coach Dunn one of the best compliments ever. Is that he told him one day, he said, "Coach, you're relentless. And I think if you can be relentless like Coach Dunn was, and everything you do, you're going to be okay."
Well, I know that there are, we could sit here and talk about stories, which we, some maybe being some true and some not.
Sure.
But in the remaining time that we have with you in this segment, I'd love to hear about your team. I know, is this your first year at Hoover?
This is the third.
Third year, I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You said that. Talk about the team this year. I know that when we were talking earlier that they can kind of control their own destiny.
Sure.
in the playoffs, but kind of talk about the personality and some of your key players.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the big thing with this team this year is more than any other team I've had is it's the closest group of kids we've ever had. And we've got 13 seniors, which is a big number, but you know that number works when you have the right kind of kids, and we do. We're lucky to have those 13 seniors, and then we've got 12 juniors and a couple sophomores that play. And we just, you know, the makeup of this group is that they're just really close in everything that they do. And so as a result of that, sometimes we've actually gotten ourselves into maybe even a little bit of trouble because they're trying so hard to have success for their teammate that maybe they put a little too much pressure on themselves. But for our team, you know, right now we have a week left of area play. And we sit at 2-2 in the area, and then Thompson and Vestavia are both 3-1. So we have the tiebreaker over them. So if we can... we have to sweep this week to get into the playoffs, and then if they will split on their side, then we would have a chance to host the first round of the playoffs. And if somebody sweeps on their side, we'll be on the road in the playoffs if we can take care of our job.
Now, you were saying that high school baseball is basically a six-game season.
It is.
I mean, the important games. But I know you play a lot more, but if someone gave you the ability to change the format, mm-hmm. Would you do anything different?
Oh yeah, I think every coach here that you talk to in the state would want more games to count. You know, I think you know, when it's six games, you look at teams, you know, take Hewitt Trussell for example right now, they had a bad week, and next thing you know, they may not make the playoffs. And I think everybody who
that would be unbelievable.
It would be, and they're the number one ranked team in the state, and you know, they just got cold at the wrong time. And the thing, you know, baseball is such a team sport, especially at the higher levels. You know, there's not one guy that dominates for most teams. And so, you know, I think if we could get more games that count, I think it would just make baseball better in the state.
Now, I know we talked about previously how, you know, I asked you, you know, what's the biggest rival, and your reply was, you know, there's so many good teams. Talk about the caliber of baseball in this area and then across the state.
Sure. You know, the crazy thing about baseball here is that every coach, and this all started back with Coach Dunn. Coach Dunn, maybe when he was coaching, was a guy who is one of the few baseball guys, right? And now everybody's a baseball guy. You don't have the guy who just got given the baseball job. He really is
coaching
a
football
coach. Right. You don't have that anymore. You've got all baseball guys. And the minute you think you've got a rival, or the minute you think you want to focus just on one team, somebody else is going to sneak up and beat you. But if you look at the teams we've been able to play, you know, Helena is ranked number one in the country by some publications and computer rankings. And I would say that they're as good a team as we've played all year. But then you just go up the road to Coleman, and they're great. And you look in our area, you've got Vestavia's got Caden Lemons, who's, you know, potentially a top two-round draft pick in the draft. He's 6'6", and throws 96 miles an hour. And you know, that's just one guy on one team, but everybody's got guys that are really, really good. And if you don't come to play that day, it's going to be a bad day for you.
Well, the playoffs are looming. I know you've got to be able to host the first round. You've got to sweep, and hopefully
sure.
They have a split. Do you like where you are?
I love any time I get to coach these kids. And I know every coach says it, but these guys, and you'll see it in a little bit on the show, but you know, this group of kids, the personality is great, but I do love our attitude and our competitiveness. And when you have to go on the road to a place like Tuscaloosa County, where you're already down two before you get there, you know, you want to take guys that like to compete.
Is there a reason for that?
It's just a hard place to play. I'll stick with that. It's a hard place to play.
Any surprises? Anything that surprised you this year that somebody, a player, gelled or went beyond expectations? Or
no, honestly, no. It's the year we thought the kind of players we thought we would have and the cohesiveness we thought we would have. You know, we saw this coming, and I think our coaching staff and our administration saw this coming. And you know, if you'd told me at the beginning of the year we'd be in a week where we had to win two games to get in the playoffs, I would have said, well, let's just go play the two games and we'll be done with everything else. And so that's where we stand right now.
Well, Coach, again, we thank you for being here. It was great to meet you, even though you coached at Vestavia. We're gonna forgive you for that.
Not anymore.
But we look forward to talking to your players, and we wish you good luck in the playoffs.
Well, thank you very much.
To make the playoffs.
Well, thank you. I hope we can make it.
All right, we'll be right back, and we'll be talking to three of those players, outstanding players, in just a moment.
The next time you need electrical work, whether it be commercial or residential, you need to call Huffman Electrical Contractors. A company that's been in business for over 35 years, they've served clients not only locally in the Birmingham area and all over the state, but have clients outside the state of Alabama as well. Whether it's a new building or remodeling an older building or home, they can handle the job for you. Once again, that's Huffman Electrical Contractors. The number to call is 205-661-5005. That's 205-661-5005. We're at Huffman Electrical Contractors. A satisfied customer is always their number one objective.
At Andrew Sports Medicine, we partner with our patients trying to help them overcome the obstacles that keep them from achieving their goals.
This practice aggressively pursues victory over injury, over pain, over limitation, over anything that's going to keep you from being the best you can be.
It starts with our non-surgical physicians who are trained in sports medicine, orthopedic injuries. We have specialists in sports medicine with shoulders, elbows, and knees. We have hip specialists that do only hip surgery, including arthroscopy, minimally invasive resurfacing, and total hip replacement if needed. We have joint replacement surgeons. We have spine surgeons. We have surgeons that specialize in foot and ankle surgery and in hand surgery. So just about all the specialties of orthopedics are covered at Andrew Sports Medicine.
What makes the great surgeons great is their volume of experience at making decisions, whether that's intraoperative decisions, post-operative decisions, pre-operative decisions, the decision to operate on somebody or not operate on them. And so our volume here breeds good decision-making. That gives us an edge in terms of making decisions for our patients, which ultimately is a lot of times the difference between success and failure. The teams, the players, the parents have confidence in us because they know we're going to communicate with them. We're going to create a plan unique to that athlete or that person. And we're going to get them back to their thing as quickly and as safely as we can.
At Andrew Sports Medicine, our mission is to partner with our patients and to help them succeed and achieve victory. Whether you're a weekend warrior, a grandparent with a shoulder problem, or a professional athlete, you get the same care, the same high-level technology, the same aggressiveness that we would in a professional athlete, and we treat everyone the same way. None of us like to lose. We're all very competitive, and we're not going to lose against their illness or their injury.
Have you had that Mexican food fix yet? If you haven't, then Speedy's is the place to go. Located in Hueytown, one block off Warrior River Road on Forest Road, you can call in your order or go through the drive-thru or dine in as our family and friends do on a regular basis. For everything from nachos to enchiladas to taco salads, you can't beat the taste of Speedy's Mexican food. Remember, that's the original Speedy's is back and better than ever. To phone in the order or for more information, the number to call is 744-4659. That's Speedy's Mexican Foods.
The community features a world-class resort and spa, the amazing Robert Trent Jones Trail Golf Course, miles of historic trails, and the whole family loves the pool at Ross Park.
Now, are we gonna have to watch your vacation slides all night?
This was supposed to be a party.
Well, this isn't my vacation. I live here.
Ooh.
All All right, folks, welcome back to the Central Alabama High School Sports Show. I'm Max Harbuck. Snapper Lancaster couldn't be here tonight. His wife's undergoing some medical tests, and he had me come in and pinch hit. We just talked to Coach Adam Mosley, the head coach, baseball coach at Hoover High School, and now we got three of his outstanding seniors, and they're primed for a big series this week as they need to take care of business to be in the playoffs, and we're delighted to have them here with us. And I'm going to introduce them from left to right. Garrett Farquhar, who is the senior shortstop, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
He's also the quarterback for the state champion Hoover Buck football team. And in the middle is Drew Guffey. He is he plays a position that's near and dear to me because my son played at Hoover, played first base a number of years ago. And on the far end down there is Tyler Williams, and he's kind of a dual position player, plays in the infield and the outfield. But gentlemen, good to have you with us.
It's good to be here.
Thank you.
All right, I'm gonna start with Garrett. By the way, my young son's named Garrett. Two things I like about this crew. But Garrett, your senior year, and I know you've got some games to remaining, but talk about the experience of playing not only other sports at Hoover, but baseball in particular. Talk about what it's meant to you.
Well, this has been my senior year for both football and baseball, but for baseball, it's about having a group of guys come together and being one. We've really taken the younger guys under our wing and, you know, brought them into, like, as having a good group of guys and just having fun together, just, you know, relaxing, just playing the ball that we've grown up playing all along.
Now, do you have a favorite? Can you choose between the two?
I guess I did have to because I had to pick, you know, where I wanted to go play football for Millsaps or play baseball for Shelton, and I
chose
baseball.
Chose baseball.
Yeah.
That's good for you. Now, Drew, are you a multi-sport athlete? Or?
No, sir, I'm not. I've been playing baseball. I played football freshman year of high school, but 10th, 11th, 12th grade, I've been strictly baseball.
Okay. Now, have you always been a first baseman the whole time in high school? Or?
Yes, sir, I have. Played a little bit of third base and also pitched in relief a little bit, but for the majority of the time, I've been first base.
Now, have you guys been at Hoover your whole high school career? So you kind of grew, you know, you've known each other quite a while.
Yes, sir.
Now, Drew, do you primarily play in the infield or in the outfield?
Infield.
I'm sorry, I was talking to Tyler. Excuse me.
I play in the outfield mostly. I play right field. I started the year at third base, and then they moved me to the right field.
Okay. Garrett, talk about this series that's coming up with Tuscaloosa County. I mean, that's a big deal, isn't it?
Yes, sir. It's a big deal, but I mean, we understand what's supposed to happen in these two games. We, you know, we treat it just like every other game we've ever had, just like the Vestavia series, just like the Thompson series, get ready to play. You know, everybody has the right mindset, no underdoing anything, you know.
Just got to take care of business. Now, I was asking Coach, when my son came up in the early 2000s and played at Hoover, Vestavia was the big rival. Who is your big rival now?
No doubt Vestavia. We just finished up a very, very intense series with them, and I think it's safe to say that rivalry is
still up there, isn't
still
it?
Still on its way, yes, sir.
I mean, I would get as a parent, I would get. When the Vestavia game would roll around, I would start getting physically feeling uncomfortable, and I know your parents may feel the same way. But now I know that you were talking about the Vestavia series, Tyler. Y'all had y'all won 2 out of 3, didn't you?
Yes, sir.
And that what was it? A walk off home run by one of your teammates?
Yeah, signed Chara.
That was
pretty. Pretty big, and we were really pumped about it, and we got up to the plate, and it was probably the craziest thing that's ever happened, like, in my high school baseball career.
So that's going to be on the highlight reel then.
Yeah.
I agree. Now, where was that played? Was it at Vestavia or was it at home?
We played game one at Vestavia.
That's right.
And then 2 and 3 at Hoover.
Yeah.
You know, they do things different. We used to play, go through all of our area and then turn around and go back through, and it would be, they would switch, you know, either, it would be sort of home and home kind of thing. Garrett, one of the things that I know that all three of you guys are going on and playing at the next level, talk a little bit about, I know you just mentioned a minute ago, but the opportunity that you're going to play at the next level. Talk about that a little bit.
Well, it's not something everybody gets to do, so it's also, I mean, it's a, you know, great opportunity, you know. I mean, I was just very excited when Coach called me up and said, hey, do you want to come play at Shelton? I said, of course. That sounds like where I want to be. So,
well, I mean, congratulations for that. That's a great opportunity. And I know you're going to Snead State.
Yes, that's correct.
Talk about that, what that means to you.
It's an unbelievable feeling. You know, something I want to do my entire life was play college baseball. And, you know, going into my senior year, didn't really have any offers, and I was feeling a little bit discouraged. But, you know, Snead gave me a chance this offseason, and I couldn't be more excited and very much looking forward to it.
And, Tyler, you're going to Huntington, right?
Huntington, yes, sir. Yeah, I'm just like them, I'm very excited about it, and I'm glad I have the opportunity. And just like Drew, didn't really have many offers going into the senior year. And then they called me up one day and said, hey, you want to take a visit down here? And I was like, sure, because I've been there a few times and I really like the campus. And it's
that is exciting when you get that call in.
Yeah, your
somebody wants you and come on down, you know, that's great. And you're right, you get the, you know, and it could be a stepping stone to an SEC school or, you know, who knows, to the next level. So I know that's going to be great. Now, what, you know, looking back, talk about an exciting play or moment in your career at Hoover. And Tyler, we'll start back with you. Maybe you've already talked about it.
Yeah, probably the walk-off hit by Sonny was.
Now, if it had been better, if it had been you.
Oh yeah, I was next up bat.
Oh, is that right?
Yep.
But he beat you to it then, right?
Yeah, he did. But I felt that if I got the chance, it would have been pretty cool to get up there and maybe have the walk-off.
What about you, Drew?
Well, you know, I think we got such a tight group of guys. You know, when I'm up to bat, you know, with runners on base and I'm able to get a big hit, I think anytime you do it, the best feeling is being able to look at your dugout and they're all getting excited for you. They're all fired up. And I can think back on, you know, numerous times when you just you do it for these guys and you're just glad you can do it, and so it never gets old.
Garrett, what about you?
I'd have to say, you know, either making a big play in the field and looking back at your pitcher and saying, "Man, I got you. Like, I'm here for you." No doubt, like just saying, like,
"I got your
he
back."
Says,
right?
Yeah, he says, "Thanks, man. I'm here all day."
Well, guys, I wish there was another 10, 15 minutes we could chit-chat, but the little clock there is ticking down. So, but I, first of all, I want to say it was a pleasure meeting all three of you and good-looking guys and obviously good students, good athletes. But I want to wish you the luck for the rest of the series and take care of business at Tuscaloosa County. And then I want to wish you luck and at the next level when you leave Hoover and go out and make a name for yourself. And we hope that we'll see your name in lights in the future.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you very
All right,
much.
We're going to be right back. You'll see a segment, as we talked about earlier, with Dr. Jeff Dugas with Andrew Sports Medicine. He'll be coming up. That segment will be coming up right after these messages.
The next time you need electrical work, whether it be commercial or residential, you need to call Huffman Electrical Contractors. A company that's been in business for over 35 years, they've served clients not only locally in the Birmingham area and all over the state, but have clients outside the state of Alabama as well. Whether it's a new building or remodeling an older building or home, they can handle the job for you. Once again, that's Huffman Electrical Contractors. The number to call is 205-661-5005. That's 205-661-5005. We're at Huffman Electrical Contractors. A satisfied customer is always their number one objective.
The community features a world-class resort and spa. The amazing Robert Trent Jones Trail Golf Course.
miles of historic trails, and the whole family loves the pool at Ross Park. Now, are we gonna have to watch your vacation slides all night?
This was supposed to be a party.
Well, this isn't my vacation. I live here.
Ooh. And this will be your premium right here.
Sorry to interrupt. I just wanna say, I combined home and auto with State Farm.
Saved $760.
Love this guy.
Okay. Does it bother anybody else that the mime is talking? Freaky.
Bundle home and auto, and you could save $760.
That's 760 very good reasons to call Alan Gurdeau in Trustville today.
I have a gentleman here who's not dressed like a coach, and there's reason for that. Of course, we're talking about Dr. Jeff Dugas of the Andrews Sports Medicine and Orthopedic Practice. And Jeff, always good to see you.
Thanks, Snapper. Happy to be here.
And I guess since you're coming in the attire you had in today, that means you had a busy day.
Yeah, I have to apologize for that. I had every intention of throwing the coat and tie on, but I got delayed in the OR a little bit, had a long day. So,
Jeff, one thing that we wanted to talk about in this first segment, because we're going to do two segments with you, is we're going to do football by itself, and that is talk about some of the new things. You know, when we and me and you and Dr. Kane have been with us before, we like to talk about high school athletes with their injuries, preventive measures, and all that kind of thing. And so I'm going to more or less let you talk along those lines. We want to talk about the football aspect of it first. And I know that there are times when we talk about the fact that a lot of times athletes are now hewing in on one sport, specializing mm-hmm. on one, and there's pluses and negatives for that. But first of all, start talking about that a little bit and we'll just go from there and see where it leads us.
Sure. You know, sports specialization is not a new thing. There's been a drive in that direction, I guess, for a long time. You know, people have been honing in on that. This has been a process that, you know, started probably 20, 25 years ago, and now it's gotten to the point where, especially in some sports, you know, some of the overhead throwing sports, baseball, softball, tennis, you know, things like that, basketball, it's a year-round thing. And obviously, in good weather like Alabama, you know, it's possible to play year-round. And so for a while, 10 years ago, you didn't see people in the northern states playing 12 months a year of outdoor sports. But now they've got indoor facilities up there where they can play 12 months a year of baseball and softball and things like that. So the overuse injuries that we see in those sports certainly have increased. And you know, the campaign that goes on is trying to prevent youth sports injuries. And as an example of how that trickles up, not trickles down, Billy Bean from the Oakland A's and I, he was in our office a few months ago when he was here for the SEC baseball tournament. And we were talking about how Major League Baseball's had a serious increase in Tommy John surgery in the last couple of years, to the point where there's up to, I think, double what it was maybe 5 years ago. I think they had 30-something of them. Well, his opinion, and I agree with this, is maybe we should have expected that, because the spike that occurred in the youth population occurred when those guys were 12 or 13 years old, 14 years old. Now they're 27, 28, and they're in the prime of their Major League Baseball career. So he's getting back to the point of, if we can't solve it at the kid level, we're not going to solve it at the Major League level. And so you look at kids playing sports, whether it's football, baseball, basketball, soccer, whatever sport it is, kids need time to rest, kids need time to recover, they need to cross train, and every sport and every their ability in every sport will benefit from that, for sure.
Well, the one thing that that I know that we're hewing in, especially when it comes to the football injuries now, of course there's always been the knee injuries and mm-hmm. the arm injuries, but the biggest thing that's hit the last few years is concussions.
That's right.
And what kind of steps are being taken, and I know you're there at the mm-hmm. ground roots level of it, especially for the high school athlete, because right. now the biggest thing, if there's a big hit or something like that, the first thing they're going to do is get that youngster out of there.
Well, so the concussion world has definitely changed. You know, concussion means something a little different from when you and I were growing up. We know a lot more about it now. And concussions really have kind of taken over and dominated the landscape of what we deal with, especially in the contact sports like football. So we are a little more aware, and you know, we would be, one of the criticisms would be is because we're so much more aware of some of the downsides to repeated concussions, are we over calling it? Are we over diagnosing it? My honest opinion of that is that we're not over diagnosing it. I think we are appropriately training the athletic trainers of the world. Every coach in the state of Alabama that coaches at a high school or junior high school has to go through a certified concussion training to recognize and evaluate and understand what that means. In my 17 years here, I've never met a single coach ever, one time, that had an intention to put a kid back in a dangerous situation. I just don't think that person exists in today's world, and if they do, I haven't met them yet. So I think the coaches and the trainers and the people that interact with these athletes are really doing a good job of teaching as well as understanding it. And the biggest issue that I think we have with concussions now is not an overdiagnosis, it's an underreporting. We tell the kids all the time, they have got to speak up. You don't want to have that third hit or that multiple hit game where you were a little goofy after the hit in the first quarter and more goofy after the hit in the second quarter, and by the fourth quarter you don't remember your name or where you are, and really you should have spoke up in the first quarter. And it's really up to the athlete to report that. If they don't report it, we can't act on that information. And not every headache is a concussion. Not every loss of balance is a concussion. Not every, I don't remember the play. Not every one of those things represents a concussion. It's a constellation of symptoms that you have to take in context with the athlete and knowing those athletes. And that's why the coaches and the athletic trainers who know these kids so well and interact with them on a daily basis are the ones that are most qualified to do that. And that just speaks to the importance of those positions.
Well, I know when it comes to the concussion too, one of the things that the normal person such as myself that's not as closely involved as you are, the first thing you look at is helmets.
Sure.
And it seems like that every year they try to improve the helmet in such a way that it will take more of an impact. But like you and I and Dr. Kane in particular have talked about before, the athletes today as compared to yesteryear, they're quicker, faster, stronger.
They are.
And they're in better condition. And sometimes these hits that they make, they are violent hits.
They are. And you can't. There's no question the technology, helmet technology, has significantly improved. And excuse me, who wouldn't want their child to be in a good helmet? The helmets are commercially available. The parents can go buy them if the school doesn't provide them. They're expensive, and the schools do a good job of providing the best that they can. The most important thing when it comes to a helmet, you can have the best helmet technology on earth. If it doesn't fit the kid properly, it's not going to do its job. So every helmet maker will tell you, the helmet has to fit the head properly. So the most important day in a helmet's lifespan is the day it gets fit to that kid. Once you get past that, the kid's going to get hit. Helmets are there to take impact. It's not just the impact, though. There's a rotational component to it. There's a shearing component to it as the brain shears within the skull. Every helmet can't protect you from rotational injury. It may protect you from impact in certain planes, but it cannot possibly protect you from every rotational force.
And one thing I think, too, that you just pointed out that people don't think about, lay people such as myself that are in the coaching profession, that head coach, you get an idea if a youngster's hurt, but the most important thing is for that youngster, like you say, to let the coaches just know how he's feeling,
right,
that things aren't exactly right. But of course, a lot of times a player doesn't want to do that for the simple reason the coach is going to take him out.
So that's right.
I guess the coaches have also got to say, guys, don't be afraid to tell us if you've taken a significant hit.
Right. And so at the professional level, and with the trainers and the coaches, you know, the coaches and the trainers, you almost know what to look for. And you can tell in talking to a player, just in interacting with them, if they're okay, if they're all there, if they're looking a little glazed, if they're not quite right, if they're making bad decisions. We had one at Vestavia a couple weeks ago, and the way we knew it was a kid who normally makes a play or reads the progressions or reads the things that he's supposed to be doing on the field, and he was just not covering it. And we knew from based on that he wasn't okay, and he wasn't going to speak up. But you got, and that's where you got to walk up to that kid and you got to ask him, or you know, what's that?
The community features a world-class resort and spa, the amazing Robert Trent Jones Trail Golf Course, miles of historic trails, and the whole family loves the pool at Ross Park.
Now, are we gonna have to watch your vacation slides all night?
This was supposed to be a party.
Well, this isn't my vacation. I live here.
Ooh.
The next time you need electrical work, whether it be commercial or residential, you need to call Huffman Electrical Contractors. A company that's been in business for over 35 years, they've served clients not only locally in the Birmingham area and all over the state, but have clients outside the state of Alabama as well. Whether it's a new building or remodeling an older building or home, they can handle the job for you. Once again, that's Huffman Electrical Contractors. The number to call is 205-661-5005. That's 205-661-5005. We're at Huffman Electrical Contractors. A satisfied customer is always their number one objective.
Have you had that Mexican food fix yet? If you haven't, then Speedy's is the place to go. Located in Hueytown, one block off Warrior River Road on Forest Road, you can call in your order or go through the drive-thru or dine in as our family and friends do on a regular basis. For everything from nachos to enchiladas to taco salads, you can't beat the taste of Speedy's Mexican food. Remember, that's the original Speedy's is back and better than ever. To phone in the order or for more information, the number to call is 744-4659. That's Speedy's Mexican Foods.
Folks, want to tell you about, once again, a new sponsor that we have on our program, and we're awfully glad. We've been affiliated with them on and off, and we've got them back on with us, and we're talking about Andrews Sports Medicine. They're the world-renowned sports medicine physicians and orthopedic surgeons there at Andrews Sports Medicine and Orthopedic Center. They bring decades of experience and dedicated research in their respective fields. They are highly trained orthopedic specialists providing the most advanced sports medicine available in the United States. This group is well known for being the official sports medicine providers for the Alabama Crimson Tide, Auburn Tigers, Jacksonville State Gamecocks, Sanford Bulldogs, and dozens of high school programs in the central Alabama area. However, they are also available to provide folks such as us, you and me, who have an athletic mindset, the experts that is, but also the real experts at Andrews Sports Medicine aggressively pursue victory over every injury. Go to AndrewsSportsMedicine.com to start making your comeback today. Welcome back, and once again, we remind you, we're talking to Dr. Jeff Dugas of the Jim Andrews Sports Medicine and Orthopedic Center. And I tell you what, Dr. Dugas, talking about the concussion issue, probably the number one, especially for a football player, is we're talking about that knee injury.
Yep.
Now, to get to that specifically, what I think the only difference in today's athlete and athletes of years ago is the technology in that field. It has grown immensely too. Talk about that a little bit, especially from that dreaded ACL injury.
ACL tears a part of sports, you know, and as long as people are moving fast and cutting side to side, we're going to see ACL injuries. That's just the nature of the beast. We've gotten pretty tuned at how to fix these things, and we've gotten pretty knowledgeable about what it takes to come back from them. Excuse me. Excuse me. There was a push for years to try to get people back faster, get them back in 4 months, get them back in 5 months, have them back on the field. I think that most of us at this point, especially in the elite kind of or high level sports medicine world that deal with, you know, high school, college, professional athletes, even Olympic athletes, there's more danger in getting people back quicker. It was almost a bragging right thing to say, hey, I got this guy back in 4 months. You know, like we were like that made us a better surgeon if we had him back in 4 months. I'm at a point in my career where I don't want to see somebody come back in 4 months because I know the risk they're taking and the chances that they're going to re-injure that thing. And the second time around is never as good as the first. So there's still a big push on the part of the industry and the athletes to get back on the field faster. And our job as the sports medicine professionals is to get them back as quickly as they can safely participate in their sport and protect themselves. Biology does not happen faster in anyone's body. So if it takes somebody 8 months to get back and somebody 4 months to get back, the biology of healing is the same in both of those. And you want that graft to be vascularized, incorporated into the body. You want it to be functioning like a normal ACL. And that just doesn't happen in 4 months. So there is some risk at the 4 month point, at the 6 month point, that isn't there at the 8 month point and the 12 month point. And we are starting to realize that there may be some benefit in actually taking a little bit longer to get back to it. There are still times where we push it. I had an occasion this week where I told a senior in high school that we were going to try to make it work without an ACL as a lineman and a senior. And he has a chance maybe to go play, if he can perform well, maybe go play at the next level. That's a tough decision for me to make or to recommend with a family. And it was a unique situation with this kid that doesn't happen very often. Normally we would tell that kid to get it fixed and see if he could walk on somewhere. It turns out that, you know, this kid actually tore his ACL 4 or 5 months ago and has been playing all summer with it, played the first two games with it, and it was only in the third game that he had a problem. And so maybe we can kind of work through that a little bit with this.
One other aspect I wanted to be sure that we got to touch on a little bit tonight was the fact that trying to make these parents understand that making a youngster specialize in one sport and wearing out his body too soon as prepared compared to the fact we're used to you as a 2 or 3 sports star, use different parts of your body and then we don't wear out any in particular. Talk about from that aspect, because I know now more and more it seems like the parents want their child, once they get to be a teenager or whatever, to find one sport, then let's do it 12 months a year.
It's not just the parents though. At the high school level, you know, the football coach has the football player lifting football weights in the off season. Even though they may be playing baseball or basketball, they still expect them to do their football stuff. The basketball coach expects his kid to play AAU basketball in the summer to maintain their skills. The baseball coach expects his kid to play travel ball in the summer. And so it's not just the parents, it's a combination of all of them. And don't forget the athlete. The athlete wants to do these things. It's not like they're being dragged kicking and screaming to go play AAU basketball or go play travel baseball or have a 7-on-7 tournament in football. This is part of the now culture of the high school athlete world. And I think that what you really have to look out for is not giving the body rest and trying to be a specific type of athlete when your body isn't prepared for that. As an example, I say all the time, you can't be a football player during baseball season and a baseball player during football season. If you've got a bunch of muscle on your defensive lineman and you've put on 20 pounds of muscle to play that position, you don't need to go try to take 500 swings in the batting cage. Chances are you're not loose enough to do that. And by the same token, you can't be bench pressing, maxing out in the weight room in the middle of baseball season if you're going to then go throw or pitch, you know, after school in a game. Those things are mutually exclusive. So you kind of have to be a baseball player during baseball season and a football player during football season.
Well, one thing that you have to look at too, Dr. Dugas, isn't the rewards are high by doing all that, but also the gamble you take with maybe hurting yourself, or the risks are a little bit higher too, aren't they?
All the time. And we see those things. We have those discussions with patients about how they came to make the decision to I had one yesterday, or yesterday was the holiday. Last week, I had a kid come in and I asked him what made him think he should be using creatine in the middle of August and September in football season. And creatine is a supplement that helps to build muscle, but it's an off-season supplement. And so kids can get this stuff. You can buy it at the gym. You can buy it at GNC. You can buy it anywhere. It's not illegal, but it's dangerous if you don't know how to use it properly. And that's just one example of not doing it right. It's no different than a bad technique in the weight room. It's no different than trying to throw a ball improperly or not running when you're, you know, not stretching before you run, you know. If you and I didn't stretch before we ran, we'd tear something. Well, guess what they're going to do too? They're younger than we are, but they can still tear things. So, got to prepare the body.
Well, one thing as time winds down, it gets away from us quickly. We're talking about the fact that sometimes we want to be so active that we overdo it.
Yeah.
And it's like we're in a hurry to get to nowhere sometimes, and instead of just backing off, being the best we can be. But in our society now, everything's about winning. You're not a success unless you're a winner. And there's nothing any further than the truth. And you know this as well as I do. You can gain, and I've had coaches in every sport tell me this, you can gain more from losing a game than you can winning one, because it's easy to be a winner.
Yep.
But you have to pick yourself up and just keep working at it and to be the best you can be to finally, if you are a loser, to become that winner. But you've worked so much harder at it. So I don't know. Sometimes it's almost like we're seeing mixed messages, isn't it?
I worked in Coach Jim Valvano's office when I was in college. And I can remember what he used to tell the kids on the first day of practice or when they'd come in for recruiting visits. He said, I want you to fail. Because if you fail, I can teach you. If all you ever do is succeed, you're not going to get any better here. He would tell them, I can't wait for you to fail, and then I can teach you and make you better.
Well, in the last couple of minutes we've got, Dr. Dugas, I think the thing that I would want you to try to relate to parents, coaches, athletes, is the fact that probably the most positive thing you can do is the best you can not to overwork that body.
That's right.
I mean, there's such a thing, like you said, seasonal, and you can even play more than one sport, but you can't mix and mingle with the working out. No. Exercising from one into another. So if you could say something a little about that as we wind it down, maybe it might help someone along the way.
You know, every athlete has to know their own body, and they have to know what their body's capable of, and they've got to be willing to speak up and say, I just can't do that today. You know, if you're a thrower and your arm is sore, you don't want to throw in pain in high school. That's a never event. If you can't run, if you can't cut and pivot, and you're trying to play defensive back, number one, you're probably not going to be very successful if you've got a bad ankle sprain and you can't run. But number two, you're not going to get better, you're going to get worse, and you're hurting the team. So if you don't speak up, you're probably doing more harm than good to yourself, but you're probably doing more harm than good to your team. And it's the rare athlete who 75 or 80% of them is better than 100% of the next guy. Those studs play on Sundays. And you know, we're talking about a different brand of athlete. So I would tell parents and kids, pay attention to your body. Listen to what your body is telling you. If it's trying to tell you something, you ought to be listening.